Look here at Matthew chapter 18. Last Wednesday night, we looked at verse 22 specifically, and that interesting equation that the Lord gives, 70 times 7. And since we're working here in Matthew chapter 18, what I'd like to do this evening now is focus specifically on verse 20, okay? Matthew chapter 18, and this is what we read at verse 20. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Our Father, once again, we thank you for your grace, your goodness. We do thank you for your love, and we pray as we come to your word, again, may we have clearer understanding regarding the outworking of your purpose, certainly here, vested in Messiah and the nation of Israel, the little flock in particular. We pray that our time together would prove to be edifying and certainly enlightening, and as we are better equipped with the verses, may we be available to help those that can often be confused by the mishandling of Scripture, especially when dealing in the book of Matthew. We do once again pray for Brother Richard, not only for Brother Richard, but for others in our midst that are going through difficult times, whether physically, emotionally. We know who you are. We know your word sustains, and we know that you've given this this living entity, the church, the body of Christ, to be available to help minister, comfort, and be available. As always, may our time together prove to be edifying and enlightening, and we do ask it, of course, in Christ Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Verse 20, all too often can be a very misunderstood passage of Scripture. There are two very common interpretations of verse 20. And interestingly enough, I actually read a third interpretation of verse 20. But you might hear that verse 20, when the Lord here describes where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. One very common interpretation is that this regards prayer. And the idea here is this, that if you can find two or more individuals that will pray the same thing, they will have a better chance of having the prayer answered. So I guess your answer to prayer is exponentially increased the more people that you have praying for you. So that is one way in which people understand verse 20, that if there are two or three together in my name, he is going to pay attention and he will be available to answer prayer. Another common interpretation, verse 20, is this is what is required to be a church gathering. In other words, you're not really a church until you have two or three gathered together. And I thought, well, why is that the case? I actually read an article. The gentleman, he argued that you can't take the Lord's Supper. You can't participate in the Lord's Supper unless you have a minimum of two people. So I guess no one is allowed to take the cracker or the juice on their own. I guess that would invalidate the Lord's Supper. So there are some ways that verse 20 is sometimes understood. But what we'll do this evening is just let, number one, the context help us understand what the Lord Jesus here is talking about. And then we're going to look at other occurrences in Scripture where we read about two or three. Okay, so at the outset, we really do need to read the context. That is always the most healthy and safest way to study any single verse of Scripture. It all begins in verse 15. So let's just glance back to chapter 18, verse 15. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. Do you notice the formula here? Two or three. So right off the bat, we have to begin to wonder why the formula two or three. Drop back down to verse 20. For where two or three are gathered together, well, the Lord has already set the table. What the Lord Jesus here is doing is he's providing a prescription. He's giving to the believing remnant a process in which to deal with church discipline. Okay? And by the way, not only are we going to appreciate, I hope, some things in the media context, but the language that the Lord Jesus is going to use here, in fact, the formula two or three, is taken right out of the Old Testament. Not only that, look there at verse 20 again. For where two or three are gathered together, that's an Old Testament concept. In my name, that's an Old Testament concept. There am I in the midst of them. That is an Old Testament concept. So we certainly want to guard against just isolating one single verse and forcing our theology into it. We're going to let the language tell us what the Lord Jesus is focusing in on. Now, going back to verse 16, but if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. Now, be careful here. The expectation isn't to locate two or three witnesses that I witness the trespass. Be a little careful here. Rather, there is the call for two or three witnesses to observe the process that's going to take place. That's quite a different thing. Think about it. So if you can sin against a brother, as long as there's only one witness, you're off the hook. If you have two witnesses or three witnesses, now you're going to have to be investigated. So the issue here with the two or three witnesses that every word might be established, it has more to do with the process, the witnesses that are going to be engaged in an investigation. That's what's going to happen here. There's going to be an investigation. There is going to be a hearing. There's going to be a verdict. And then there's going to be discipline meted out. So think about this. Clearly, we have the language of a kind of like a courtroom proceeding, okay? You have witnesses, by the way. Witnesses are used in a court of law. And these witnesses are going to establish the word that is being said. There's going to be a hearing that entails an investigation. Then there's a point after which the investigation concludes that a decision is going to have to be rendered. So they're going to have a verdict. And the verdict either says, yes, you did it, no, you didn't. They would have to determine the severity of the trespass, the offense. After that, then there needs to be some sort of sentencing or discipline. So when we begin to roll this whole process around in our thinking, we'll better appreciate why the Lord says what he says in verse 20. So let's go back to verse 17. And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as an heathen man and a publican. Well, if this guy doesn't repent, he doesn't cooperate, then you have this issue of excommunication, if you will. This guy is not willing to participate in the community discipline, in the church discipline. For whatever reason, hard-hearted, he's he's arrogant, he's proud, he's very self-defensive, but he's not going to participate. So the end result is you basically treat him like a publican. He's going to be an outcast, okay? That is a very harsh sentence that can potentially be meted out. How is that sentence arrived at? Who's going to decide at what point the guy's going to have to be treated in such and such a manner, okay? Verse 18, now notice, the Lord's going to continue here. Verse 18, verily I say unto you. Now, in the context, who is the Lord Jesus Christ specifically addressing and who's he talking to? Glance up at verse 1, right? 18, verse 1. At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus. So the Lord Jesus here, he starts to discuss conflict within the brethren, okay? And by the way, will there be conflict among believers? Yeah, and certainly there will be conflict among believers, even in the believing remnant, okay? And with that said, Jesus is providing an orderly process. If followed, Jesus in effect is saying, I will honor and respect the decision that is going to be made if the process is properly followed, okay? With that in mind, now notice verse 18 again. Verily, I say unto you, keep the context in mind here. Church discipline, you 12 guys, I'm saying to you disciples, whatsoever ye, again, plural, he's talking to the whole group here, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. The Lord Jesus, he's now communicating to the disciples that they are given a capacity to exercise governmental authority. And with that said, we also learn in verse 18 that heaven is officially going to recognize the decisions that they arrive at. Whatever they bind, heaven will recognize it. Whatever it is they loose, heaven is going to recognize it. So the point here is this. These representatives of Jesus Christ, they're going to function in their official apostolic capacity. And whatever decisions they render in the context, when it comes to an offending brother, a sinning brother, a brother who trespasses, when it comes to the issue of church discipline, they are to act on behalf of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're supposed to operate in light of the instructions of the Lord Jesus Christ, in light of the wisdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, in light of the instructions and commands of the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's critically important that they are responsible to function as official representatives of the King, of Messiah, and his governmental system. By the way, go over to chapter 16. The language in verse 18, whatsoever ye bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Remember what the Lord told Peter back in Matthew chapter 16. He says in verse 19, the Lord talking to Peter, and I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And you know what kind of imagery that entails. To have the keys, that is representative of authority and power. And I don't mean unbridled fleshly power, but a position of rank. So Peter is given the keys of the kingdom. Why is that significant? And whatsoever thou shalt bind. Now, you notice whatsoever thou, singular, right? Because Jesus is talking to Peter. Whatsoever thou, Peter, shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So here, and by the way, this is at a point in time, verse 21, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Here's the point. Jesus Christ, Messiah, in anticipation of his impending crucifixion, his rejection, his exile, is preparing Peter to exercise his authority. You've got the keys. And the decisions you will make will be honored, recognized, and they will be validated by heaven. Now, we might have a little time. Does that mean Peter can make any decision he wants without exception? Now, be careful. We'll see that that does not mean he can go ahead and make any decision that he personally wants to make. All right, we're not dealing with that. The point is this. Peter is given this authority in anticipation of the rejection of Jesus Christ. Now, as we get to chapter 18, and in the context, verse 15 and following, there is this issue of conflict among the members of the little flock, among that Jewish remnant, the Jewish church. Well, what Jesus Christ is doing now is he's extending the authority to, here we go, verse 18, verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye. So it isn't just Peter himself, it is now extended to all of the disciples. Ye shall bind, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever ye shall be loosed on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So here's the point. What is Jesus Christ doing? He's going to be rejected. He even is going to prepare his disciples. He's going to tell them, I'm leaving the world. I'm going to ascend unto my heavenly Father. And in my absence, you gentlemen must function in my stead. You're going to have to make decisions as my official representatives. So the Lord Jesus, he's getting ready here. And they need to get ready for what is about to happen when the Lord Jesus is going to depart. Going back down now, again, now look at verse 19, Matthew 18, verse 19. Again, I say unto you, he's talking to his disciples, that if two of you shall agree on earth. Now, be careful with it. Jesus is still talking about church discipline. He's still talking about a process that he is setting up in dealing with someone who is trespassing against another brother. Will that individual be willing to comply with the witnesses, their investigation? Are they going to comply with what decision will be arrived at? Verse 19, again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything, and I'm going to say it one more time, that does not mean anything without exception. And I'll give you two verses to prove that, not right now. That anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my heaven, of my Father, which is in heaven. But in the context, what is Jesus dealing with? Verse 20, for where two or three are gathered together in my name. Again, he just told us back there at verse 16, the end of verse 16, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. Now, the context, number one, the context prevents us from assuming that Jesus is making some sort of a promise that, okay, just get two or three people praying the same thing. Or if they're praying independent of each other, but they're praying about the same thing, then Jesus says, I'm going to honor it. No, the Lord is saying, I will honor and respect the process in dealing with a brother who has trespassed against another brother. That's quite different. So the context demands that we understand verse 20 especially. It has to do with this investigation. It has to do with the hearing, okay? Now, what I'd like to show is that this isn't the first time you run into this kind of language. Two or three witnesses involved in an investigation and God saying, I'll be there. And not only will I be there, but you do it in my name. By the way, when the Lord, of course, in verse 20 says, if you're gathered together in my name. By the way, to be gathered together, the idea here is there needs to be mutual agreement. If there are two or three that are mutually agreed upon the decision that is going to be rendered, the verdict, the sentence that will be meted out, it has to be in my name. That is, it is in his capacity. It's in the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? He says, I'll be in the midst of them. And before we go to the Old Testament here, some people would take the language in the midst of them as being some sort of mystery, invisible presence of Jesus. And or his omnipresence. By the way, we know the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, he's God. He can be omnipresent. But is that what the Lord Jesus is saying? Now, let's go over to Deuteronomy chapter 19. In Deuteronomy chapter 19, we find a passage that parallels what Jesus is instructing his disciples to do. And this is kind of an interesting thing. Let me do this first. When the Lord Jesus Christ is setting up his governmental structure, we know, of course, he's the king. Under the king are, of course, the 12 disciples. The king, he is, I'm going to just write it out now so I don't have to come back to the board. He is the Lord. What did Jesus say about the 12 disciples? Remember there in Matthew chapter 19, verse 28, he says, in the regeneration of the Son of Man, you 12 guys will be sitting on 12 thrones, and what are they going to be doing? Judging. So I just want you to appreciate the structure here in light of an investigation and an impending verdict, all right? A brother who's trespassing, church discipline. We're going to see language that is going to mirror what we're going to read here in Deuteronomy chapter 19. Involved in the process is the Lord, judges, and by the way, underneath, okay, you have the king, Lord Jesus Christ, and he tells these guys, you guys are going to sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. So they are going to exercise authority over Israel. I hope that is too. What do we know about Israel, believing Israel, in the millennium? Really quick, keep your finger in Deuteronomy chapter 19, but I want to turn over to 1 Peter chapter 2. And 1 Peter chapter 2, I just want you to recognize the structure here. 1 Peter chapter 2, and we read there at verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people. So what do we know about regenerated Israel in the millennium? They're going to function as a kingdom of what? Priests. When Jesus is describing a courtroom proceeding. Notice, now let's go back to Deuteronomy chapter 19. Deuteronomy chapter 19. And we find a mirror situation, if you will. Deuteronomy chapter 19. And I'll begin reading at verse 15. Deuteronomy 19, verse 15. By the way, Paul is going to talk about two or three witnesses as well. And we'll get over there in just a minute. Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 15. One witness shall not rise up against a man for any iniquity or for any sin, in any sin that he sinneth. At the mouth of two witnesses or at the mouth of three witnesses shall the matter be established. If a false witness rise up against any man to testify against him that which is wrong, then both the men between whom the controversy is, number one, shall stand before the Lord. Now, just remember what Jesus said in Matthew 18, verse 20. where two or three are gathered in my name, he says, I will be in the what? Midst of them. Okay, so think about now, going back to verse 17. Then both the men between whom the controversy is shall stand before the Lord. By the way, in Matthew 18, the Lord won't be literally physically present. Okay? Now keep reading verse 17. Shall stand before the Lord, before the priests and the who? The judges, which shall be in those days. So think about the structure here. Now, there are some things we want to take note of here in Deuteronomy chapter 19. What's happening in Deuteronomy chapter 19 is what I guess we would call the Supreme Court. Okay? There are lower courts in Israel's life. There are lower court. By the way, we have lower courts here in the United States of America. God designed a system where legal cases will be dealt with. And there are lower courts, there are local courts, but when it comes to certain legal matters, then there is the need to bring it to the highest court. The highest court is you bring it before the Lord, okay? So, for lack of a better word or description, just kind of consider what we're reading here in Deuteronomy chapter 19 as, quote, the Supreme Court. Now, I'm going to read verse 17 again. Then both the men between whom the controversy is shall stand before the Lord, before the priests and the judges, which shall be in those days. Now, look at verse 18. And the judges shall make diligent inquisition. So who's going to start the questioning? Who is leading the investigation? Verse 18, it's the judges. It's not the Lord who is personally, intimately asking the questions. He's not conducting the interrogation. He's not the inquisitor. He's not the one who is challenging witnesses or getting statements. You know what God is doing? He's giving that responsibility to the judges. Here's the point. These judges are going to act as God's representatives. If you lie to these judges, you're lying to God. When these judges pass sentence, they pronounce a verdict. It's God who is pronouncing the sentence and passing the verdict. Just recognize how the Lord is doing it. Verse 18, and the judges shall make diligent inquisition. And behold, if the witness be a false witness and hath testified falsely against his brother, then shall ye do unto him as he had thought to have done unto his brother. So shalt thou put the evil away from among you. And those which remain shall hear and fear and shall henceforth commit no more any such evil among you. So at the, quote, Supreme Court level, the Lord, judges, go over to chapter 17, Deuteronomy chapter 17. And let's pick it up at verse 6, Deuteronomy chapter 17, and notice at verse 6. At the mouth of two witnesses or three witnesses, by the way, if anything, when Jesus Christ in Matthew 18 refers to two or three witnesses, he isn't just pulling numbers out of a hat. This isn't out of, he's taking you back to the Old Testament. What the Lord is saying to his disciples is what they should have already understood is happening in Israel's national life. And in Israel's court system, there needs to be judges who will inquire. They're going to conduct this investigation. Verse 6 again, at the mouth of two witnesses or three witnesses shall he that is worthy of death be put to death. But at the mouth of one witness, he shall not be put to death. The hands of the witnesses shall be first upon him to put him to death, and afterward the hands of all the people. So thou shalt put the evil away from among them. Verse 8, if there arise a matter too hard for thee in judgment, between blood and blood, between plea and plea, and between stroke and stroke, being matters of controversy within thy gates, then shalt thou arise and get thee up into the place which the Lord thy God shall choose. Now think about that. What place is the Lord going to choose? Ultimately, it's going to be his sanctuary. Ultimately, where is God, by the way? When he says, you're going to take it to the highest court, if you will, you're going to take it to the highest level, and you're going to take it to the place that I choose, it's going to be his dwelling place. If you keep your finger here, go over to chapter 23. Keep your finger in Deuteronomy 17. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 23. And notice the language in verse 14. Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 14. For the Lord thy God walketh in the midst of thy camp. What is Jesus saying in Matthew 18, verse 20? If two or three of you are gathered together in my name, that is, you guys come to mutual agreement in my name, in the authority that I have invested in you as my official representatives, I'm in the what? I'm in the midst of thee. Well, that's what God is in the midst of the nation of Israel. Verse 14 again, for the Lord thy God walketh in the midst of thy camp to deliver thee and to give up thine enemies before thee. Therefore shall thy camp be holy, that he see no unclean thing in thee and turn away from thee. One more verse, go to Leviticus. Leviticus chapter 26. And notice here in Leviticus chapter 26, verse 12. Let's read verse 11. Leviticus 26, verse 11. And I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you, and I will walk among you, and will be your God, and ye shall be my people. The place of God's choosing, it's the place where he tabernacles. It's the place where he dwells. It's going to be the sanctuary. So now go back to Deuteronomy chapter 17, and let's finish up the passage here. So now we're dealing with a legal controversy that is going to require the highest judicial level. And so verse 8, the Lord says, the end of verse 8, get thee up into the place which the Lord thy God shall choose. Now look at verse 9, and thou shalt come unto the priests, the Levites, and unto the judge that shall be in those days, and inquire, and they shall show thee the sentence of judgment. The language, you don't see the Lord directly rendering the judgment. You know what the Lord is saying? I give to the priests and to the judge. In fact, we already read in chapter 19, the judges are going to make inquisition. Here's my point. The Lord is in the midst of all of this, but he's not directly involved in any of this. Do you see the difference here? The Lord can officially recognize the decisions that his judges and priests are going to make. And whatever decision they arrive at, if they go through the proper God-ordained process, God says, I will honor it. That's what the Lord Jesus is saying in Matthew chapter 18. You get two or three, I will honor the decisions that are rendered if you're following the correct process. Verse 10, and thou shalt do according to the sentence which they of that place, which the Lord shall choose, shall show thee, and thou shalt observe to do according to all that they inform thee. Do you see what's going on here? The Lord doesn't have to be directly involved in every case. He's giving the judges and the priests divine authority. And he's saying, whatever verdict, you are going to obey it. Whatever sentence they show you, you will do according to the sentence. Verse 10, which they of that place which the Lord shall choose shall show thee, and thou shalt observe to do according to all that they inform thee. And you can just keep reading. So it's just rather fascinating. When Jesus, he imparts official authority. Whatever you bind, it'll be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose, it'll be loosed in heaven. You guys are going to function as my representatives. You are the judges. Those 12 guys are going to be doing what these judges are doing. The nation of Israel, as a kingdom of priests, they're going to be doing what these priests are doing. So it's just absolutely fascinating. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 21. Deuteronomy chapter 21. And notice there at verse 5. Deuteronomy chapter 21 and verse 5. And the priests, the sons of Levi, shall come near. For them the Lord thy God hath chosen to minister unto them and to bless in the name of the Lord, and by their word shall every controversy and every stroke be tried. You see the authority that these priests are given, but their word, their decision, the most controversial cases that are brought before the Supreme Court, God says they're doing it in the name of the Lord. So the point, let's go back to Matthew chapter 18. The Lord Jesus Christ, number one, the immediate context. There's a legal trial going on. Secondly, the Lord is using language already available in the Old Testament when it comes to a court proceeding. The witnesses, investigation, the interrogation, the verdict, the sentencing. So when we read verse 20, for where two or three are gathered together, they're united in the decision that they're arriving at. They're doing it in my name. There am I in the midst of them. That's going to be his official recognition. He's officially honoring what his surrogates are doing. And when I say surrogate, it almost sounds demeaning, but they are his representatives. Let's go over to 1 Timothy chapter 5. And notice, interesting here, in 1 Timothy chapter 5, notice what Paul is exhorting Timothy to do. And although it is not the same scenario as Deuteronomy, but there are some fascinating parallels. If you read Deuteronomy chapter 19 and then read 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 19 through verse 21, you're going to find some parallels. It's not the same system. We understand that. But 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 19. Against an elder, receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses. Now, please note, verse 19, very carefully, against an elder, receive not an accusation. That isn't just, I'll hear you out. If you can find two or three witnesses that literally saw this elder commit whatever infraction he committed, that is not what Paul is talking about. When he says, don't receive an accusation, but before two or three witnesses. What Paul is saying to Timothy is, listen, if an elder, a church leader, pastor, whatever, if an elder out there is being accused of wrongdoing, Timothy, you don't even listen to it unless you have two or three witnesses to witness the process. You see what's going on here? God is going to honor the process in just a second here. So, and by the way, I mentioned to the Tuesday class, I think it's in Saudi Arabia. somebody will correct me. I believe it is in Saudi Arabia, and I apologize if I have this mistaken. I remember hearing that, if a woman in Saudi Arabia is raped, and she accuses her rapist of raping her, she has to have 7 witnesses that the rape took place. Now, what are the odds of bringing the rapist to prosecution and to trial and to, you know what, the odds are no. There has to be 7. So that is, Paul isn't saying you got to have 3 witnesses of the wrongdoing. He's saying this is the process. Verse 19, against an elder received not an accusation, but before 2 or 3 witnesses. Them that sin rebuke before all, that others also may fear. By the way, you have that language back in Deuteronomy chapter 19. But notice verse 21, I charge thee before who? God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels, that thou observe these things without preferring one another, one before another, doing nothing by partiality. You know what the Lord Jesus, you know what Paul is saying here to young Timothy? He's saying, listen, Timothy, you must ensure that the investigation is carried out the way God intends the investigation to be carried out. You need to render the verdict. You need to render the sentence. You need to render that decision as though it is the way God would have done it. In other words, Tim must respect and honor the process in dealing with the wrongdoer, if you will. And by the way, verse 21, don't take matters in your own hands. Don't show or exercise partiality. Don't favor. And you know, if you got a brother in ministry who's being accused of something, you know, there could be the tendency of, you know, kind of protecting and so on and so forth. But the point is this, Timothy, you conduct the investigation before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels. There's an issue here of respecting and honoring the authority, the power that is vested in you, Timothy. So here's my point. You have Paul using the 2 or 3 witnesses, and Paul lays out the process of investigation that God intends to be utilized. And Timothy is expected to honor that. And if he honors it, it is as authoritative as though God is the one who renders the decisions that are being made. Go back to Matthew chapter 18. So it's clearly much safer when the Lord in verse 20 talks about 2 or 3 witnesses, or I'm sorry, 2 or 3 are gathered together in my name. Oh, it's clear in the context he's dealing with discipline and investigation, so on and so forth, okay? In my name, my authority, and I'm in the midst of them. I'm going to recognize it. I'm going to honor it because they're following the God-designed process. Let's, for the couple of minutes that we have remaining, look at verse 19 one more time here. It's kind of interesting. And again, I say unto you, you guys, you 12, that if 2 of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Now, this is fascinating because I just want you to notice how the Lord Jesus applies the language anything in the context. When Jesus says, if 2 of you agree on earth as touching anything, in the context, he's talking about church discipline. He's talking about the investigation. He's talking about the trial, if you will. So the anything isn't being applied in the sense of anything without exception. And that is consistent. Here are two verses. Go to Luke chapter 9. Go to Luke chapter 9. And notice in verse 54. Luke chapter 9. And notice there at verse 54. Verse 54, Luke chapter 9. And when his disciples, James and John. So how many disciples are there? Two. Remember what Jesus said. If two of you agree on earth as touching anything. But Jesus is going to apply what he's going to apply the anything in the context. Well, look at what these two guys are going to do. Verse 54, James and John saw this. They said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? Well, are these two guys in agreement? Why don't we just call down fire and let's just burn them all up? And you know what Jesus says? Are you guys out of your mind? Look at verse 55. But he turned and rebuked them and said, ye know not what manner of spirit ye are of. Wait a minute. What happened to anything? You got two disciples. Hey, Lord, we both agree. Let's call fire down. And interesting, Jesus says, you don't know what kind of spirit. That is not the spirit which is to lead his men when it comes to agreeing on earth about anything. One more verse in that regard. Go to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, and notice there at verse 35. The point is this. Anything does not mean anything without exception. In the context of Matthew 18, the anything has to do with the trial. In Mark chapter 10, verse 35, here we go again. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come unto him, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldst do for us whatever we shall desire. Hey, the two of us, we have come together and agreed on this particular issue. And what is it? Verse 36, and he said unto them, well, what do you want me to do? Verse 37, they said unto him, grant unto us that we may sit one on the right hand and the other on the left hand in thy glory. Well, did these two guys come to agree that that's what they want? And what does Jesus say? Verse 38, Jesus said unto them, ye know not what ye ask. So this idea, whatever you ask, you'll get it. There's limitation. There's clear restriction. You better know what you're asking for, and you got to do it in the right spirit. Now, a couple of verses, go over to John chapter 15. Just a couple more verses and we're done. Go to John chapter 15. And notice what the Lord says here, John chapter 15, verse 7. Look at John chapter 15, verse 7. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall what? Ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. What is the prerequisite? Ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done. What is required before the end of verse 7 is going to come to pass? Verse 7, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you. You know what the problem is? When they said, let's call fire down in heaven, that wasn't the words of Jesus Christ. Jesus in his first coming wasn't about wrath and consuming his, you know what, you understand what, that was the bad spirit. That was not the spirit of Christ. The words that I say unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Listen, you can have what you ask done, but it's got to be based upon the words of God resident in their heart. A couple more verses and we're done. Go to 1 John and notice how 1 John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, look there at verse 22, 1 John chapter 3, verse 22, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Why? Because we keep his commandments. Verse 24, and he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. That's exactly what we just read about in John chapter 15, verse 7. If my words dwell in you, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, listen, it's got to be the words. It's got to be the commandments. You'll get what you ask, verse 22, because we keep his commandments. And then one more passage, chapter 5. Look there, chapter 5, and then verse 14. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything, but notice, according to his will, he heareth us. Can someone ask something that isn't according to the will of the Lord? Let's call fire down. Jesus says, that's not the right spirit, gentlemen. Let us sit next to you. You don't know what you're asking. That isn't the will. Now we're going to end. James, go to James. Chapter 4. And notice what James says in James chapter 4, verse 2. James 4, verse 2. Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Look at verse 3. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lusts. All right. Matthew chapter 18, verse 20, when two or three are gathered, it's within the context, the carrying out of a process that is going to address a brother who trespasses against another brother, and the need for two or three to come to mutual agreement in the decisions that they're going to make regarding that erring brother. Jesus says, in effect, I'll honor it. I respect it. It's being done in an official capacity as my representatives, and it is as authoritative as though Jesus himself is coming to those decisions. Father, we do thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your word. And Father, we just thank you that we can certainly understand it in its clarity, and we can certainly be free from a lot of the religious traditionalism that can sometimes affect the reading of verses. We just thank you that we can have the confidence in letting your word instruct us. And we just thank you for it in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.